Greetings, friends. My name is Jason Jones. I serve as senior pastor for the Bartlett United Methodist Church. Our mission is to know Christ and to make Christ known to all people through worship, education, and service in our community and throughout the world. We are blessed to have this opportunity to worship with you on this Lord's Day morning, and we pray that you find blessing through our offering. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. For our call to worship, please respond as indicated on the screen. The kingdom of God is here and coming. A mustard seed that someone took and sowed in the field. It is the smallest of all the seeds, but when it is grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree in which birds can nest. The kingdom of God is here and coming. Yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all was leavened. The kingdom of God is here and coming. Treasure hidden in a field which someone found and hid, then joyfully sells all and buys the field. The kingdom of God is here and coming. A merchant in search of fine pearls, on finding one of great value, sells every possession and buys the pearl. The kingdom of God is here and coming. Let all who have ears hear. Let us pray. Welcoming God, we come to you as we are, seeking approval, seeking forgiveness, seeking to find our way home. Help us to welcome others, just as we would like to be welcomed. And teach us to value the rewards that come from a life of servanthood. Help us embrace the cost of discipleship, that we may be welcomed into your eternal home. This we pray in the name of Jesus, who taught his disciples to pray. And so, with confidence that we are your children, we join our voices to the voices of those first disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning. School is about to start, and I know this year that's going to look different. But one thing that's not different is the aisles filled with school supplies. Walmart, Target, Kroger, Walgreens. You can't help but walk into one of those stores and see all of the new school supplies, which always makes me so excited. There's nothing I love more than a new planner, crisp folders, and new notebooks ready to be filled with all of the knowledge of the year. One of my favorite school supplies is always the new pencil. The sharp point, fresh eraser, it's ready to take down and record all of that new information that you're about to learn. Now I know, pencils are becoming a thing of the past. You take your notes on computers now, or if you're really brave, with an ink pen. But to me, a new school year would never be complete without fresh pencils. But regardless of how you're gonna take your notes, you need one thing when the school year starts, and that is your ears. Because without your ears, you wouldn't know what to write down or what the teacher was saying. You need to be able to listen to what others are saying in order to record it. Now, sometimes I think we fall into the habit of listening just so we know when we can speak next, right? Waiting for that cue in the person's language to know, it's my turn to talk now. We don't really care or hear what the person is actually saying. We're just waiting for a chance to say what's on our minds, on our hearts. Well, God would not like that very much. God wants us to resist the urge to tune out others. He wants us to stay alert and listening with both of our ears. That is part of being a good friend, a good student, and just a good person. Listening when others speak and really paying attention to them. It's also what James told the early church to do. In James chapter 1, verses 19 and 20, it says, My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. If you want others to listen to you, you have to be a good friend and a good listener yourself. Friends need us to hear them, to pay attention, and to let them know we understand. When we listen, we gain understanding and we get to know what others need. When we listen, we know how to pray for our friends to help them through difficult times. Listening isn't always easy, and it's something we need to pray about, something we can ask God to help us with. We need to practice being quiet, listening every chance that we get, asking questions when we don't understand, and always waiting to respond until after you hear what is being said. I want you to think about that as we begin this transition in this new school year. It's going to be different, and there are going to be questions, and we need to use both of our ears to hear what is being said. Will you all pray with me this morning? Dear God, thank you so much for giving us two ears to be able to listen with. Please help us to remember to focus on what is being said by others and not what our reaction to them will be. Lord, help us to prepare our hearts, our minds, and our ears for the school year ahead, that we may be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to anger. Lord, help us remember we can always turn to you to aid us in patience as we focus on what we should be doing. Thank you for loving us and having patience with us as we continue to strive to be closer to you. We ask blessing on those here in body and in spirit, and that you be with us all. We ask all these things in your Son's most precious name. Amen.
Let us join together in our prayer of thanksgiving. Most gracious and loving God, we come with hearts full of gratitude, full of thanks for the abundance of your love, for the many blessings that you shower upon us, and for our desire to say yes to your love, so that we may experience the outpouring of your Holy Spirit. Lord, we know there are trials, but above and through it all, you are there. So we give thanks for the contentment of our souls, for we know who we are. We are yours. And your promise gives us hope and life everlasting. Dear Lord, we pray that our faithful response to love others as you have loved us holds true and fast in all that we are, and all that we believe, and all that we do. We give thanks, dear Lord, for those who offer in that faithful response their time, their talents, and their gifts, so that your love may be revealed and made known to all we come in contact with. So, Lord, we ask that you take all that we are, all that we have, that you multiply it and use it for the work of your kingdom. And we pray all of these things in your Son's most holy name. Amen.
Your kingdom come, and let your will This morning, our gospel reading comes to us from the gospel according to St. Matthew chapter 13, verses 31 through 33, and verses 44 through 52. Matthew 13, 31 through 33, and 44 through 52. And here's what it says. He put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all the seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they threw it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. And this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Who knows how long I've loved you? You know I love you still. Will I wait a lonely lifetime? If you want me to, I will. It had been a little while since I had incorporated any Beatles lyrics into a sermon, so I figured that it was overdue. The words that you just heard come from their 1968 song, I Will, recorded for and released on their self-titled LP that most folks know as the White Album. Written by Paul McCartney, the song, while perhaps not one of their better known, is one of my absolute favorites, because it speaks of someone's undying, someone's unwavering commitment to the person they adore. One part makes this especially clear, where it says, love you forever and forever, love you with all my heart, love you whenever we're together, love you when we're apart. It's a beautiful, beautiful depiction of complete devotion. And as we gather around God's Word this morning, continuing our journey through this season of growth and maturation in our relationship with Christ, we find that the lessons we have encountered so far seem to be offering us the same, very lucid depictions, images of devotion, unmistakable examples of the form that true commitment takes. And in our gospel lesson for today, as has been the case for the past couple of weeks, we hear Jesus once again sharing a parable with his followers. Actually, he shares 5. unless you count the last line of the passage. And he does so one right after another. A sort of verbal Rorschach test where he displays several word pictures and then asks the disciples what they make of them. As an aside, I find it rather amusing how readily they affirm that they understand what Jesus has said. Because how often did the disciples demonstrate that they truly understood anything that Jesus said? Read through the gospel accounts. They get it wrong a lot. But here, each of the parables point to the same thing: the kingdom of heaven. Possibly not the easiest topic to discuss or to comprehend. And to be sure, each illustration Jesus employs characterizes the kingdom in a different way or highlights a different aspect. Its mystery, its incalculable worth, even its composition. But the overarching statement that Jesus seems to be making is that to be part of this kingdom requires a great deal of commitment from those who would be his followers. And I find this to be especially true in that image of the mustard seed with which Jesus introduces this selection of parables. Because he says that the kingdom of heaven is like one of these seeds. Because it starts out small, but grows to be very large, providing shelter and, I would assume, nourishment for certain of God's creation. Indeed, some have estimated that the shrub produced by the mustard seed may be as much as 3,000 times bigger than the seed itself. And these images of growth, they can be both inspiring and encouraging at the same time, and they should be. And still, I don't think that they are the whole of what Jesus is calling our attention to. Because it's what's beneath these images of growth that, from my perspective, speaks most profoundly. Because while it's true that a mustard seed's growth rate is pretty substantial, even more impressive is the plant's persistence. Any good horticulturalist will tell you that, in fact, the growth produced by the mustard seed is almost impossible to get rid of. Pliny the Elder, ancient Roman author and philosopher, wrote in his volume entitled Natural History that mustard is extremely beneficial for the health. But once it has been sown, it is scarcely possible to get the place free of it, as the seed, when it falls, germinates at once. And maybe that's why Jesus chose this image. Because surely he could have incorporated any number of much larger trees into his simile. Those which were taller, or those which were stronger, or those which were more pleasing to behold. But instead, he chose to depict the kingdom as a plant with firm footing. A plant with great durability and with deep roots. Yes, the kingdom grows where good seed is planted in good soil, but it grows exponentially where the roots are the deepest. Where our belief in and commitment to God in Christ goes beyond lip service, goes beyond intellectual assent, and enters a place of entire commitment and complete devotion, a place where we seek God's presence continually, pursuing the things of God as a hidden treasure or as a pearl of great value. Commitment. It was the way in which young Eugene Orowitz lived. The skinny, awkward, self-conscious kid from New Jersey was very shy. And he lacked confidence. But when his high school coach half-jokingly asked him to try out for the track team, Eugene took him up on it. Eugene, as his friends affectionately called him, fell in love with javelin thrower and gave himself, dedicated himself to being the very best that he could possibly be. And so what Eugene lacked in self-confidence, he made up for in commitment. So much so that by the time he graduated high school, Eugene had achieved a national high school record for throwing a javelin 211 yards. His commitment to excellence also earned him a college scholarship in sunny California. There was even talk of him competing in the Olympics. However, torn shoulder muscle ended his javelin throwing career and any hope that he had of making the Olympic team. However, as fate have it, Eugene discovered a new love one day while watching a play. He fell in love with acting. And so just as he had committed himself to his sport, he committed himself to be the best that he could be in acting. He was determined to make it in the ridiculously overcrowded profession and become famous, and so he enrolled in an acting class. And wouldn't you know it, Eugene Orowitz went on to star in three of the most popular shows in television history, Bonanza, Little House on the Prairie, and Highway to Heaven. Of course, you may not remember seeing his name in the credits because it appeared there as Michael Landon. Commitment is also the way in which Jacob pursued the woman of his dreams in today's prescribed Hebrew Bible lesson. The 29th chapter of Genesis tells us that Jacob wanted more than anything to marry Rachel. So much so that the poor lovesick fool agreed to toil for his relative Laban for 7 years, presumably because he had no other means of paying the customary bribe. But we are familiar with the tale, I think. Laban tricks Jacob, pulling the old switcheroo on the night of the wedding and giving his older daughter Leah to Jacob instead of Rachel, which incidentally is not entirely unlike what Jacob had done to Esau some years prior when stealing their father's blessing. But where Jacob's amazing commitment to Rachel really stands out is in his refusal to accept the circumstance. Even though most scholars calculate that he was around 70 years old when he began to work for Laban, he paid off his 7 years, which the Bible says seemed to him but a few days because of the love that he had for Rachel. But being tricked, he could quit, He could have lost heart, he could have given in, and most folk probably wouldn't have blamed him. But you know that he worked 7 more years so that he was 84 by the time he was finally joined to his beloved. And I got to be honest, guys, such dedication makes most of us look awful. But that was the kind of commitment that Jacob had to the one whom he loved. And looking at these different examples, I don't know about you, but they challenge me in terms of commitment to God. Even if we are among the smallest of seeds, we shouldn't let that stop us from planting our roots deep and growing into something useful and productive. We have to be committed to God in such a way that no deficiency, no setback, no disappointment, no uncertainty would deter us from giving our very best and striving toward the one whom it is that we love. But even so, we need to remember that our commitment to God actually begins with God's commitment to us. Which is to say, before we can say that we love God, in the words of Mr. McCartney, forever and ever or with all of our heart, we have to acknowledge that what is most important is that God first loved us with an all-encompassing and abiding love. St. Paul's letter to the church at Rome demonstrates this beautifully. In one of the most beloved passages in all of Scripture, as we are reminded that the Spirit helps us in our weakness. It reminds us that all things work together for the good of those who love God, who are called according to God's purpose. Both sentiments reminding us of the ways in which God takes care of us and provides for us and directs us. And yet the centerpiece of the apostles' assertion comes in what follows. As he says, nothing can separate us. Nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing can separate us. And of this, Paul was convinced. He was convinced of the absolute permanence of God's affection for the creation and for all of humankind, a passion so measureless and strong that the very Son of God was not withheld, but was given up for all of us. God's love for us and God's commitment to reconciling all things to God's self through the redemptive work of Christ, that is primary. Because it is where connection between God and creation begins. To state it simply, God's love for humankind and God's love for all of creation is not only permanent, it also precedes anything that we think or say or do. It comes before any allegiance that we may show. But any healthy relationship is always reciprocal. And so we respond to what God has done with a loving commitment of our own. And so, dear ones, the challenge before us today is to contemplate and to reflect upon the sort of commitment that we are offering to God. How devoted are we? How deep do our roots run? How much do we strive toward cultivating our relationship with our Maker? To what lengths would we go for God? You see, it's good to acknowledge and needful to acknowledge God's amazing and free grace that affords us unconditional love and freedom from sin and death. But when we do only this, it leaves us at the halfway point. Because we are called to be those who say, if you want me to, I will. We are called to return the affection that we have been shown, which we do, as we are conformed to the image of God's Son. My prayer is that we would make this our aim, that His image may shine in and through our lives, offering redemptive light to all. May it be so. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. This morning is our response to the Word. May we join our voices together in the affirmation of faith. It comes from the United Methodist Hymnal on page 885. I invite you to follow along with the words on the screen. This is a responsive affirmation, so I will begin, and then we will all join our voices together. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom, power, and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope, and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ and find strength and help in time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in the service of love, as set forth in the example of our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen. Now receive these words of benediction and of blessing. Children of God, go forth in peace. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.